Are you ready to take the next step in moving your life and ministry forward? It's time to get a better understanding of who God has called you to be and how your unique gifts fit in the kingdom. Zion is a place of growth and deeper understanding of the Word of God. Give your time and talent to truly make a difference in the lives of others. Join us as we do life together. Find your fit, find your faith, find your future here at the Mount.
God bless each and every one of you. This is Bishop A.M. Moore reaching out to remind you that you're loved, you're cared about, and you're missed. We're praying for your mind. We're praying for your marriages, your families, your money, as well as your physical well-being. We're serious about ministry, but we're also serious about souls and lives. And so we are taking innovative and creative ways to continue to keep some level of normalcy. And most of all, we're trying to hear the Lord to make sure that we're always putting people before anything else. God loves you, so do I. Know that you're missed, you're loved, and you're prayed for. Until we meet again. This is the day that the Lord has made, and we are rejoicing and glad therein. Thank you for joining us here at the MT Zion Cathedral Church, where we are loving ministry, loving God through loving people. The vision of this house is that you know God, you discover purpose, you identify gifts, and you serve to make a difference. According to John 13:35, by this will all men know that you are my disciples, by how you have loved one for another. John 10:10 says, the thief cometh to steal, to kill, and to destroy, but he has come that we might have life and have it more abundantly. This is customarily a part of our worship experience where we would do what we call pass the love, but we are having to adapt, and we're going to just release it in the atmosphere. Will you just share these words after me by simply saying, I'm graced for this crisis. I'm graced in this crisis. I'm graced in this crisis. God bless you. Now, in our very own way, Pastor Cree Little will be coming to usher us into the presence of God through the ministry of song. Receive her as she comes now in her own way.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. We are graced in this crisis. And today we're just going to praise the Lord. Praise God for the grace. Praise God for the favor in the midst of it. We just want to praise you, God. Hallelujah. Woo. I just wanna praise you forever and ever and ever for all you've done for me. Blessings and glory and honor, they all belong to you. Thank you, Jesus, for blessing me. I just wanna praise you forever and ever and ever for all you've done for me. Oh, blessings and glory and honor, they all belong to you. Thank you, Jesus, for blessing me. I just want to praise you forever and ever and ever for all you've done for me. Oh, blessings and glory and honor, they all belong to you. Thank you, Jesus, for blessing me. I just wanna love you forever and ever and ever for all you've done for me. Yes, blessings and glory and honor, they all belong to you. Thank you, Jesus, for blessing me. I just wanna love you, oh, forever and ever and ever for all you've done for me. Yes, blessings and glory and honor, they all belong to you. Blessings and glory and honor, they all belong to you. Blessings and glory and honor, they all belong to you. Blessings and glory and honor, they all belong to you. Blessings and glory and honor, they all belong to you. Thank you, Jesus, for blessing me. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. We serve a great God. Hallelujah. We not only serve a great God, but our God is so great, he makes ways out of no way. Our God is a way maker. Our God is a miracle worker. Anytime you find yourself in a situation you can't get out of, call on the name of Jesus. I dare you. God is a miracle worker. Hallelujah. And not only that, but he's a promise keeper. Hallelujah. 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 We can obligate God to his word. He has to come through because he is a promise keeper, and he's my light in the darkness. Hallelujah. He is the light in the darkness. Hallelujah. 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 I know we'll make it through this. I know we'll make it through this because I see God on the other side. Hallelujah. Not only do I see him on the other side, but I feel him right here with me walking to the other side. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God is a light in the darkness. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to your name, God. Glory to your name. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. Hey, for you're a way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Oh, you're a way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are here, touching every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, mending every heart. I worship you. I worship you. For you are here, turning lives around. I worship you. Yes, God. I worship you. For you are here, healing every heart. I worship you. I worship you. Yes, for you're a way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Oh, you're a way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Oh, you're a way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Yes, you're a way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light. You. You are here. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Just bask in the knowledge that God is here. In the midst of everything you go through, God is here. That's the testament of it all. God is here. You are here. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Glory to your name. Hallelujah. I worship you. I worship you. Cause you are here. Hallelujah. Glory to your name. You are here, God. And we worship you. We worship you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord. Glory to your name.
Amen. He's deserving to be worshiped for who he is and what he continues to do in an exceeding and abundant way. He's a way maker, a miracle worker, a promise keeper. He's light in darkness. He is God. Will you bow, God, again? We invoke and invite your presence to come into this atmosphere that we find ourselves in. Show who you are. Do what you do as only you can do it. Speak to us and speak through us by way of your spirit, as he is the teacher, helper, and the witness of God. I covet the best gift for this assignment, and I ask now that you would stand in my body, think with my mind, speak with my tongue, that your kingdom come and that your will would be done, and that your word would become the truth that we treasure, that graces us with the ability to triumph over every trial, tribulation, and tragedy that we might encounter in life. Get all of the glory now as you add to our story. In Jesus' matchless name we pray, amen. If you love the Lord, can you celebrate him right where you are? Can you celebrate him right where you are? Can you give him the fruit of your lips, the lifting of your hands, the clapping of your hands, some expression to say to him that you value who he is and what he's done and what he's yet doing? We thank God for him and the experience and the expression that we are able to enjoy. We're in a series of teaching that's focused on grace in a crisis, grace in a crisis, grace in a crisis. And an old school song that resonates in my spirit now that I grew up on, that meant the world to me. Amazing grace, how sweet, yes, sir. The sound that saved a wretch like me. I was lost, but now, yes, sir, I'm found. Once I was blind, but now I can show enough see. And then it would get good to them boys, and they would just say, praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Praise. praise God. Has anybody got a reason, a right, and a responsibility? Praise God. Praise God. Praise. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Listen, I invoke and invite your attention to join us now in the Johannine Gospel, the book of John, chapter number 1. And we're going to look at verses 6 and 17 will be our sermonic spotlight as we look into the essence and the truth of the Word of God concerning that. John is the 43rd book of the Bible. It has 21 chapters. It has 879 verses. It has 19,175 words you will find recorded in John. The theme of John is to emphasize Jesus the Christ, the Messiah, the Savior of the world. When we look at this first chapter of John, the first five verses deal with the eternal Word of God. Verses 6 through 12 deal with John being the true witness of who God is. Verses 14 through 18 then reveals and exposes us to the Word of God becoming flesh. Yes, it is John. John, the Lord has been gracious unto me that writes and tells us this great truth. I want to use as a subtopic the same grace even in a crisis. I want to use as a subtopic the same grace even in a crisis. The same grace even in a crisis. Our focus is to share this God's ability to grace us and to provide different forms or expressions of His grace even in the midst of a crisis. Crisis don't change God, but we should see God in different forms of who He is, even in the difficulties of life, in the difficulties of life. I'd like to share a quick story to segue us into the discussion for today. There was a person of notoriety that seemed to always do well no matter what season they found themselves in. And finally, a young person walks up to this seasoned individual, and it looks like that life was good to them no matter how circumstances and seasons and situations hit their lives. And they asked, they said, Miss Jones, it looks as if you're the same and God has been good to you year after year. I remember when I was in your Sunday school class, and I remember when I went off to college, and I remember even when I came back to the ministry after being married and having my own family. And it looks to me that God has not stopped blessing you. What is it that you do in order to get what it is that you've gotten and continue to get? And she just simply said to the young man, baby, it's the same grace. He graced me then and He's gracing me now. Because the God that you and I serve, Job reminds us, yes, that He's the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. I came to give it to you this morning. And so when you recognize and you realize that the grace of God is the sustaining ability of God to do for who He chooses, what He chooses, and how He chooses to do it, no matter what the circumstances, the situation, or the circumference of life might encompass them with. God has a way of showing you He can do it again, just like He did it before. The same grace, the same grace, the same grace, the same grace. And so we talked about the importance of understanding what crisis deals with. Crisis deals with the instability or danger that happens that affects the social life, the economical life, the political arena, or global or international affairs that causes an individual to have to make a decisive change. It is not optional in some regards in crisis. You've got to do something different in order to get out of what it is that you're in. But I found something interesting as I perused the pages of the Gospel of John. John, this great writer, unlike the three other boys, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, John takes a different approach to describing this indescribable God in which we serve, that now has come and shown the second phase of his personality by coming to be among who he created. When we see him as the Father, he sits as the authority figure. When we see him as the Son, we see him as an exemplary figure. But when we see him as the Holy Ghost, we see him as an indwelling guide to get us to our destination. And so when we look at this and we examine this and we observe this, verses 1 through 5 tells us that the Word is eternal. Verses 6 through 13 then tells us, John says that there was one sent of God, that was not God, but came to bear witness of him. But then when we get to verses 14 through 18, it then tells us, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. And it said, and the Word became flesh and then dwelt among us, and he was the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. This word begotten, monogenes, monogesis, mono one, Jesus, genes. He was the only one that was from God, that is of God, that now brings God to us. He is the monogesis. But it was verse 16 and 17, verses 16 and 17, that tells us something very interesting. Look at the text, talk to us, if you will, and it says, and of his fullness, of his what? Of his fullness have we all received, we received and grace for grace. Okay, please don't miss that. And that's what got me, y'all. That's where we're going to hang our hat, our halo, and discuss it. And then verse 17 concludes by saying to us, for it was Moses that we got the law, but it was grace and truth that came through Jesus Christ. Can we walk this thing out and get on up out of here? Listen to the text talk to us. It says, and of his fullness have we received this grace for grace. Okay, y'all don't see it. The grace for grace. And so now what Miss Jones was telling that young man and what I'm telling you is that God places a particular grace on our lives that allows us to be able to navigate through the circumstances and the situations of life in a way that makes it look easy when it's really hard. Are y'all understanding what I'm saying? I've said for years now, the anointing makes what's hard look easy. And so when people see the grace of the anointing of God that's on your life, and you are handling things that they can't understand, articulate, or be able put a summation to the situation, they say, I don't know how you're doing it. And now the songwriter reminds us it's grace. And when you really begin to walk with God and understand some things, you'll say it's amazing. Because now the disciples now are on the ship with Jesus. Y'all know that's where we left off last week talking about Mark 4. The disciples are on the ship with Jesus. Jesus is asleep in a storm because he got the grace for storms. And so the storm doesn't disturb him like it is disturbing the others. And they ask Jesus, Master, careth not that we perish? Jesus, because of the grace that's on his life, gets up and says to the storm, peace, and says to the wind, be still. Are y'all understanding what I'm saying? Because of the grace. And my brothers and my sisters, sons and daughters, I've come to serve notice this morning that you've been graced for this crisis. That's the reason you hadn't fallen apart, even though it's been difficult, even though it's been challenging, even even though it's been life altering, somebody say, I'm graced for this. Can you just put that on the timeline? I'm graced for this. I don't understand all the intrinsics of it. I don't like it all the time. It don't feel good to me. It don't look good to me. But I'm graced for this. I'm trying to hold back, but when you understand. And so now you're saying, sometimes you hear people saying, I don't see how they stayed together. They graced. I don't see how they deal with what they deal with. They got a grace for it in a way that you don't, that I don't. And so now, as we hurry along, don't want to hold you long, just want to give you this little Sunday school lesson. And so I want to walk through the verse, because now I'm going to show you, it's a grace that defines you. It's going to be a grace that draws you and then directs you. And then there's going to be a grace that displays you. Can we walk through this real quick, y'all? I'll say it again so you can get it, because our professor told us on yesterday that the emphasis of the text, the summation of what you expound, you have to repeat it. And so I'm going to show you in verse 16, I'm going to show you a grace that defines you. In verse 17, A and B, I'm going to show you a grace that draws you in order to give you directives. And then lastly, I'm going to show you a grace that displays you. Can we look at that, y'all? Let's see. Can we make sense? So come with me now. In verse 16, John chapter 1, verse 16, and it says, of the fullness of his fullness have we received this grace for grace. Okay, y'all see it? There you are. And of his fullness have we all received. Who received? All received this grace what? For grace. Y'all can talk back. Y'all here, you know, make me feel like yeah, amen. This grace for grace. And so grace is the word charis in the Greek. Charis, it means to benefit or to favor. Apostle I.B. Hilliard said, grace or favor is when someone takes their power, their ability, and their influence to help you. Okay? When someone takes their power, ability, and their influence to help you, the great preacher, this mad scientist of scripture by the name of Daniels, says that whatever God doesn't remove, it is that he plans to use. Okay, so if God don't remove it, he plans to use it. Are y'all understanding what I'm saying? So whatever he's not, I'm setting you up for next week already, y'all, because we're going to talk about a little bit next week when Paul talks about what he was dealing with in his flesh, and he asked the Lord to take it away three times, and God says to him, his grace is sufficient. So whatever God doesn't remove, yeah, boy, I sense it already. He plans to use. And if he's not removing it, he's planning on using it. Can you just go on and say, whatever he's not removing, he's planning on using. It's going to be for your good. It's going to be for somebody else's gain. But ultimately, it's going to be for his glory. Whatever it is. And so now grace is defined as favor from God for service. Okay, come here. Grace is defined as favor from God for service. Are y'all understanding what I'm saying to you? Grace. His amazing grace. Okay? This grace, this favor. So, because it says it plainly, and of his fullness have we received, have we caught, have we become a part of grace for grace. Okay. So he's got to grace me for what he's called me for. Okay. Y'all understand? So if I'm not graced for it, then I'm not called for it. Yeah, y'all got to catch this. I said, if I'm not graced for it, then I'm not called for. That's the reason I can't handle it. That's the reason I can't deal with it. That's the reason it gets on my nerves to the degree that I can walk away from. I don't have a grace for that. Okay? See, I don't have a grace for foolishness. You know, I ain't grace for foolishness. Foolishness bothers me. You know, I don't have a grace for that. I don't have a grace for inconsistency. I don't have a grace for sloth. I don't have a grace for a lack of passion. I'm not graced to deal with that. My dean taught us this yesterday. He taught us the ethos and then the logos for the pathos. Okay, the ethos deals with this ethnicity to have the integrity or the character of God. Then he goes from ethnos to logos. Now it is the exegetical interpretation in the right content and context of a text. But then he goes to pathos, and that's what I got excited about, because pathos deals with this passion that one has in order to do what one does. And I like being around passionate folks that love doing what they do. See, you can wake me up in the middle of the night and give me a scripture or a Bible, and man, me and you can party because I have passion for this. I can take situations and circumstances and condition and see God in it, the logos. Now the pathos now and the logos and the ethnos, it's all got together, because now somebody's got to have integrity in this. So there's a grace that defines you. What is the grace on your life that's going to define you even in this crisis? What's going to show up about you? What's going to stand out about you? It's like being in the military, being sent on assignment to execute something that would bring the glory to who you're representing. That's what we are. We are soldiers in the army. We're fighting for the Lord. Yes, we're soldiers in his army. Y'all remember that Sunday school? Yeah. Y'all got it, boys. We're in his army and we're fighting for the Lord. And so now I have to understand there's a grace that defines me. What is it? That no matter what's happening, no matter what's going on, it's you favored in that area. You can do what others can't do and get what others don't have, because there's a grace on your life in that area. So verse 16 tells us that of his fullness, have we received this grace for grace. So he's graced. But then verse 17 says something in the A part of that verse, and it says, in summation, it says to us, for the law was given by Moses. Okay, did y'all see that? Y'all see it? For the law was given by Moses. The law, the prescription. That's what the word law in this text means. It says, was given by who? Moses. The one that name means to draw out. Okay. Y'all got me? And so now, the first form of grace is a grace that defines you, because it comes from him who created you. Because of his fullness have we received his completeness. That's what that word fullness, his completeness. Okay, have we caught this grace for? Yeah, grace. But then 17 tells us emphatically, so now there's a grace that not only defines me, but then there's a grace that draws me, because what it does, it draws me into alignment through the directives for the assignment based off of scripture. Based off of scripture. Okay? So y'all give me. So it's going to draw me into alignment. Okay? Are y'all understanding what I'm saying? Through the directives of the scripture. So Moses gave him the law. Moses laid it down. And Jesus come to say, I didn't come to destroy the law. I came to fulfill it. Y'all got me. So God is not confusing. Our interpretation is. No. He's sequential. He's systematic. And so now I've got to dig and look a little harder in order to get what he's actually saying. So now, watch this. Not only am I going to make it through this crisis, because there's a grace that's on my life to define me, but then secondly, there's a grace on my life that's going to draw me. Through the directives of the scripture. So now it's giving me direction. Come on. The law was given by Moses. Okay? Are y'all here? We're almost gone. The law we got by Moses. Okay? So Moses laid the law down. He gave us, watch this, 10 commandments. Depending on your interpretation or revelation, you're dealing with 3 to 4 verses that deal with our relationship with God. And the remaining verses dealing with our relationship with one another. So he gave us a law that goes vertical and horizontal. Okay, are y'all with me? It takes us up and it takes us out. Okay, are y'all understanding what I'm... So now he draws us. Okay, are y'all here? Then it moves from drawing us to giving us the directives of scripture. Okay, so he's not just drawing me to draw me. He's drawing me to give me directions. So now the question has to be posed or interjected right here. How well are you at following directions? How well are you following direction? It's like using your GPS system. And the objective is to get you to your desired destination. Can I tell you what the GPS for the scripture is? Okay. It's God's plan for salvation that's found in scripture. Are y'all understanding? And see, that's the reason I got to be free. That just downloaded and came to me right here. You know, don't box me in. Free me, baby, and I'll fly. And so now the first thing that he tells us, he's going to find us with grace. The second thing that he tells us, he's going to draw us with grace through the directives of the scripture. The script. Just put on the timeline. Stick to the script. Yeah. Our issue is that we don't like sticking to the script. An associate of mine, and she says something real powerful that resonated with me. She says that God told her, she says, instead of trying to get in somebody else's lane, build your own lane and I'll send the traffic. Come here. If you stay in your lane, God then is able to send traffic your way. Okay, let's go home, boys. So now the Bible becomes the roadmap to get us to our destination. Yeah, I sense it, man. Can y'all sense him up in here? So now there's a grace that defines me. What's that grace on your life? That it shows up wherever. Secondly, there's a grace that draws. Ooh. Because now it's got to draw out the darkness to get you in to the light. And then he gives us the directives of that grace. It's the scripture. You hear people giving you their opinion and can't give you no scripture. Okay. Yeah, I'm going home now, man. I sense him. Okay. So you need to understand that the Lord has given you grace for crisis. And what I came to remind you of this morning is that even in a crisis, you can have the same grace. And I'm leaving, but to be part of the verses through grace and truth, it was given by Jesus Christ. And I'm out of here now, but all I wanted to tell you this morning is that if God took you through yesterday and he took you through last year, and we weren't here in the early 1900s when the first pandemic came, but I'm here now, and even now, the same God
that has the same grace, and I'm getting out of here, but the same God that has the same grace, because the last point is that this grace is to drive you to be charitable and unconcealed. Watch this, because what the last part of the verse says, that word grace, we already know what it is, but then when we look at truth, we find out when you do the word study of truth, truth means to unconceal what has been concealed. And so whenever you're walking in truth, you're walking in the dimension that's undeniable, that's irrefutable, that cannot be hidden. And so God, now as I was meditating on this, he reminded me that when you look at it, the word cherish is the root word to charitable. And so now what God says, that grace is wrapped up in a gift that reveals the truth of who you are. And maybe in this season, what God is about to do is unwrap your gift. Yes, aren't you glad that we serve a God that even when things are looking kind of dim, looking kind of dark, looking kind of difficult, he has a way of unwrapping another gift that he's displayed in you. And I'm out of here, because God is displaying his love through Jesus Christ. Is there anybody here that remembers the Bible telling us in the Synoptic Gospels? It tells us emphatically, must Jesus bear the cross alone and all the world go free? No, there's a cross for everyone. Let me talk scripture to you. If any man desires to come after me, they must first deny themselves, take up their cross, and follow me, because all of us have a cross to bear. And I remember grace being shown in love, a love being shown through grace. How did Jesus bear the weight of the sin of the world on his shoulder? Somebody say grace. Can't you see him carrying that cross up the hill called Calvary, the Villa Della Rosa? And oh, I'm glad we have a God that knows how to be the example. Tell somebody, my shoulders are made for this, my back is made for this, my mind is made for this, my feet are made for this, I've been made for this, I can carry it, I'll carry, and I'm glad I'm through with you this morning, but it's been good talking to you to remind you that the same grace that was on you to make it through the recession in 2008 is the same grace that's on you to make it through COVID 2020. Just go ahead and say, I'm gonna make it by the grace of God. I'm gonna make it by the grace of God. Yes. Somebody say, same grace. Come on, same grace. Same grace.
Fine, I know we're not supposed to sing this tonight, but I keep hearing this. And after all that I've been through, I've got a story to tell you. He wouldn't let the devil consume me, because God knew he could use me.
God is no respecter of persons. What he's done for me, he'll do the same for you. God is no respecter of persons. What he's done for me, he'll do the same for you. Listen, cause he's given you the same grace. God has given you the same grace. God's given you the same grace. I'm talking about that Daniel grace. Same grace. Put your hand on your neighbor's shoulder. Tell him, God is no respecter of persons. Tell him what he's done.
I needed to release that tonight so some of you would understand that even though you are in the fire, the same grace that he gave Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego is the same grace that God has given you. What is that, Bishop? What is that grace, Bishop? You're going to be in the fire, but when you come out, you won't smell like smoke. You're going to be in the fiery furnace, but when you come out, you won't look like what you've been through. God's given you the same. Shoulder and tell them this.
There's a place on my life to release the glory of God. There's a place on my life to release the glory of God.
Somebody say it.
There's a place on my life.
But do what?
To release the glory of God.
There's a place on my life. We sang that last night. I ain't supposed to be singing it tonight, but I felt like somebody needed to hear it tonight. Look down your row and tell somebody, there's a grace on my life.
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 There's a grace on my life. A curse on my life, but now I got grace on my life. That's a grace on my life.
There's a grace on my life.
We gotta move because we got church in the morning. Say, there's a grace on my life.
There's a grace on my life.
And after all that I've been through, I've got a story to tell.
There's a grace on my life to release the glory of God. You have a grace on your life. that in the midst of crisis such as COVID-19, cash flow challenges, physical ailments, etc., this same God that is grace for grace will grace your life even in the midst of what looks like a no-win situation. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed, believers are praying. God, again, we thank you for the same grace that you've conditioned and positioned, demonstrating your glory and your power and your ability to take care of your children. I thank you now for these precious individuals that have shared in this scriptural journey today. And I pray now that if there are any among us that are in need of a relationship, that need to return and be restored, or in the need of a residential place of fellowship, I pray that you speak now, God. We thank you for who you're aligning and assigning, and we thank you for those that have stood strong with us even through this crisis. I pray now that you release the grace that is unmerited, that passeth human understanding. Show who you are even now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, my brothers and my sisters, God bless you. We pray that you've been blessed in the name of the Lord Jesus from our this morning depiction and presentation to let you and others know that we love the Lord and we know that he's shown up loves us. A couple of things that we want to do, and we'll be done with you. We understand that time and moments are important. First, if this is the opportunity to connect and to commit, to connect and to commit, to connect and to commit your life to this God that loves us so much that while we were yet sinners, he died for us. Well, what is the requirement? You just have to acknowledge who he is and confess who you are. You've got to acknowledge him as Lord. He's sovereign. He's superior. He's always right. He's never wrong. He's infallible. He's indescribable. He's incomprehensible. You can't consume him, but he can consume us. And so if I acknowledge who he is, the Bible says, confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, believe in your heart that God has raised Jesus from the dead and you will be saved. For with the mouth confession is made unto salvation, and with the heart man believeth unto righteousness. And so confess that I'm flawed. I need to be connected to someone that is flawless. And he says that he'll have relationship with you and you have relationship with him. Secondly, for those of us that have been in relationship, but just like any other relationship, we've fallen out. And where he doesn't walk away from us, we've walked away from him. But the good news, Isaiah tells us that all of us have been like sheep that have gone astray. And because I strayed, I don't have to stay. I can come back and never have to look back or go back to the back of the line, because he'll remove our sins as far as the east is from the west, never to bring them up again. Last but not least, if you're here under the sound of my voice and you need a residential place of fellowship, because everybody needs some house, some family that they are connected to. Well, we recommend the MT Zion Cathedral Church. We are a loving ministry, loving God through loving people, but we're not selfish. Because if you don't have the grace for this ministry and this man and this work, there's some place that's grace for you and you for it. We just want you in the family and in the right house where you can be help and be a help. I'll say it again, where you can be help and be a help to the work of that ministry. Well, our way of communicating that, there are three distinctive things. Our link, the connect link, is one way to connect with us. There's a cell number or a phone number that's listed on there. And lastly, there's an email that you use either three of those forms. And on last week, a beloved sister, a giant of a woman of God, a woman of God in the faith, connected with us. And and she used Facebook. So however you do it, we will respond, and she can be a witness. It was within 24 hours, 24-hour turnaround. You'll hear directly from me or somebody from our team. And so we're excited about your life, even in a crisis, because God has the same grace. Secondly, this is the opportunity that if you've been blessed by this ministry, by this service, by this work, an opportunity to share in the ministry of giving. God loves a cheerful giver. Don't give sparingly or out of necessity. Free will giving. If God's been good to you, if he's been faithful to you, your faithfulness to him is how you support what he supports or what he's interested in. And so we believe in tithe offering, seed sowing, love offering, etc. And there are cash apps that will assist you for both locations as well as for the Man of God's love offering. And if you're online, you're using the online platform, Giblify is what we use. And we thank those that continue to go old school, but old school and new school, sometimes they collide and it's the same school. We take checks and cash the same. It works all the same. And so we're so excited about your life and your destiny, even in the midst of this pandemic. God is the same God. And so if he's the same God, he's got to release the same grace. And we want to thank Pastor Cree and one of my daughters I love dearly for ushering with the band, us in song. Can we celebrate God for her? Amen. And then my daughter, beloved Tanisha, did not she dance her soul, our souls happy as she danced to Bishop William Murphy's song, The Same Grace. We want to thank our technical people from marketing and media that has done an outstanding job, and Pastor Kyle for assisting us as well as only he can do it. He's telling me and giving me directives even now. It's good to have people on your team. But listen, I'm excited as we are emphasizing the importance of community, we're starting our life groups this week. We're starting our life groups that will be meeting on different days this week. And you should see on the screens now, Discovering Your Inner Beauty is one of the classes that you'll be able to connect and commit to. And another class, Marriage 101, dealing with the trust factor by Ayana Van Zandt. That's going to be awesome as well. And then for those that want to get some extracurricular activity in and dance a little bit. And see, the good part about this soul to soul, this dancing, different forms of dancing, nobody ain't got to see you but you. If you can't dance like I can't, you can be in the class and block yourself out, but be able to see everybody else until you've developed some level of comfort. So please sign up. You're going to hear me helping promote it even the more. We've gotten some that have already registered, but we want each one of the classes filled or filled over. We're going to be doing everything virtual because we can care more about souls than seats. We care more about souls than seats and salaries. And so we thank God for each of you. We pray that you are blessed throughout the duration of the day. And then the last but not least of all, he really emphasized that, Express is the combination of our young adults from ages 18 through 35 that are divided up in different divisions that are able to express yourself. This is a no holds bar where as long as it's respectful dialogue and discussion, etc. But we're discussing to ultimately demonstrate something, not just discussing to say we're talking. And so we're excited. We're delighted that you joined us today. Prayerfully, something that was said through song, through dance, or through the word of God ministered to you in a way that opened you up to tell God, I want to be more like you. And so we hope that this encouraged, inspired, because there are three levels of that grace in that text. It's a grace that defines you. It's a grace that draws you. And then it's a grace that displays you. And so now you've got to be ready to be out front. Get ahead of the curve. Do something that hadn't been done before in the name of the Lord Jesus. Repeat after me. We are great people. We have great power. We leave to get great proof. Now may the grace of God, the love of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, sweet communion of His precious Spirit, rest, rule, and abide with us hence now and forevermore. May God bless you. May God keep you is our prayer.
Know God, discover purpose, identify gifts, serve to make a difference. Are you ready to take the next step in moving your life and ministry forward? It's time to get a better understanding of who God has called you to be and how your unique gifts fit in the kingdom. Zion is a place of growth and deeper understanding of the Word of God. Give your time and talent to truly make a difference in the lives of others. Join us as we do life together. Find your fit, find your faith, find your future here at the Mount.
God bless each and every one of you. This is Bishop A.M. Moore reaching out.